Right. So you start by creating a new virtual machine. I'll use a network installation. I have the URL in my history. Fedora 20. We'll need to install a text. We do a text-based install. I'll change this. But that's up to you. And we'll select a device, in my case, Dev SDK, SDK 1. The name will be Fedora 20. We'll choose a different network, but that's up to you. Let's just finish that up. This will install a Fedora 20 system. So excuse the screen, but I'll just make it bigger now so that you can read it. This should be more readable. Okay, go, 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 go. And let's just get through these options really quick. The only thing that you really need to be aware of is that to add a new user called Joe. That's one thing that you need to do. The source is processing 3, and you want a minimal installation, so you'll need to choose 12 minimal install. That's just one thing that, another thing that you need to be aware of. For choose a disk, and replace existing Linux. Continue. Use LVM, that's fine. User creation. So yeah, you need to create a user, Joe. Or actually, yeah. One. Create a user. And then set the username to Joe. Because the policy depends on that. Continue, but we'll set a password as well. 5. I'll use ABC123 for my passwords in test environments. And add Joe to the administrator group. 6, admin. And continue, and just set the root password as well to ABC123. And respond with yes, and we should be ready. Is everything set? Time zone is set, source is set, installation minimal install, the installation destination is set, the interface, network interface is set, the user creation is set, and the root password is set. So we're done. This will install a minimal Fedora system. And after that, we'll just update Fedora 20. And then we'll upgrade to Rawhide. It shouldn't take too long, hopefully. So there's two things to keep in mind. Create a user called Joe and make him a member of the wheel group, make him an administrator, and install a minimal Fedora, minimal text installation. Don't install a GUI. And it should be almost done. It's doing post-installation setup tasks. Takes a little bit. Shouldn't take too long, though. Let's go. It's taking its time. Installing bootloader, this shouldn't take too long. Reboot already. All right, press return to quit. This whole boot Fedora 20. Yeah, hopefully. Let's go. Heisenberg. Kind of a weird release. It lived so long. It almost feels like Red Hat Enterprise Linux. It has such a long life. All right, let's log in as root. ABC123. And basically what I'll do is, I'll just yum update, but I'll just exclude SE Linux for now, because it just takes so long to update SE Linux policy, and we might as well just skip it. Save time. But it's not important. If you want to update SE Linux policy as well, then go ahead, be my guest. I'm just skipping it. But I will do it when we're going to upgrade to Rawhide, which is the next step. And I'll actually upgrade in a permissive mode, just to be sure. Hopefully this won't take too long. It's using a external USB storage device, so it's a bit slow when it comes to writing. Why is it installing TMD and Jensen? Something is depending on it. Installing kernel 3.15. We're at 3.17 now, so. So now we should have a Fedora 20 that is pretty much up to date, a minimal Fedora 20 that is pretty much up to date, except for SE Linux policy. Which doesn't matter because it's buggy anyways. And now what we'll do is we'll set it for 0 just to make sure. Not really, probably not really needed, but I'll just do it anyways. And then we'll yum install Fedora release raw hype. Yeah. And then we'll go to cd etc yum repos d and disable the dot period repos d, and then we'll disable some repositories and enable some repositories. So we'll just disable and okay, let's just start by installing nano, yum install nano. Let's get that out of the way. So nano Fedora repo, and just disable this repository, and Fedora updates, disable that as well, set enable to 0, and then enable Fedora rawhide. And set enable to 1. And that's all there's to it. And then just yum update. This will take us to rawhide. Although, yeah, this might be a little slow. Because this is not. Or maybe it is, not sure. So yeah, again, a bunch of updates. Fedora 22. Kind of weird, this release. We're still on Fedora 20 for I suppose a couple of months, and Fedora rawhide is already at 22 for a while, actually for a week or two. It's not usual for Fedora to do it that way, but it's all about splitting, or we're basically going back to the old Fedora core days in a way, where you had basically one core component, and then another component which has the remaining packages. It's not quite the same, but the same idea. You have this core Fedora, and then you have these different components which for example are workstation, server, stuff like that, that you can basically, that basically build upon the core, Fedora core. Strange how things go, basically. Sometimes you have to take a step back to stay, to take two steps forward, I suppose. It's all part of the process of learning, I suppose. Sometimes you just have to experiment or experience things. As a Linux policy installing, note how long it takes. And this is one of the reasons I use my own policy and I use SECLC. As you can see, a lot of error messages when it comes to SELinux policy. It's quite a mess. It's in a dire state. But SELinux is not policy. SELinux is a framework. And so we'll just write our own policy so that we can't blame anyone else for the mishaps in the policy. Once we are updated, we'll install some packages that we'll be needing. And hopefully that'll be soon. This takes most of the time, just getting to Rawhide. A lot of error messages that I wasn't seeing when I was doing this in enforcing mode. So it seems that we may actually have a different result than I had in a previous try. I did this before just to have a look. All right, so let's just reboot. Yeah, welcome to Rawhide Fedora 22. I will start by installing some more packages. For example, and I might as well just log in as root, but okay, now that I'm here, I'll just use this. Yum, install git and rpm dev tools. Those are things that I know I'm going to need. Yeah, that's okay. So the next step is to actually build and compile the build and install the SECLC compiler that is required for this implementation. So that's why we are installing some development tools here. Exit RPM dev setup tree, I think it is. And that sets up the RPM build directory that we'll need. Now, what we'll do is we'll clone a repository, git clone http www.github.com doverwrite, and the repository is called SECLC spec git. Oh, and I forgot to install screen. So let's just sudo yum install screen. We'll be needing screen for the copy and paste and scroll functionality that it provides. Screen. All right. So we have a repository, SECLC spec. So let's get in, go in there, SECLC spec. And, not periods back, dash back. And we git log. So what we want is we want to not use the latest commit. The latest commit is breaking stuff. So we'll take the commit that starts with 635, and which is not the very latest, but the one right after that. And then what we do is we'll basically git show, and we'll have a look at the SECLC spec. SECLC spec. Here we have it. So let's just So let's just go there. So this is the spec for version 13 of SECLC, which is known to be working. So we'll copy the source URL so that we can actually can actually get the source. And that reminds me that I need to install wget. And for now, I'll just put in the URL and just enter so that it's in my history. Yeah. Okay, let's go back to the sales pack and copy now the commit. We'll need that to replace the commit macro in the URL with the actual commit. So let's go to sources. Damned. And then wget. the source wget, but replace the commit macros with the actual commit that we still have in our history or in our buffer, and this will get the source. Now let's just have a look at the spec again. We'll need to install some build dependencies. I'm getting hungry. Specs. So we depend on these, and I'll just put them in my buffer. Actually, if I do it less, then I might not have to do that. Yeah, so that's fine. So this sudo yum install Python GCC light se poll static lcov flex make core utils, which is already installed, xml2 and db latex, which actually pulls in a lot of dependencies. Text life sucks, but oh well. We actually need to compile SCCLCs, and these are the requirements to do so. And the text life part is for the documentation that is generated. Some documentation that I encourage you to read. It will be installed with the SCCLC RPM package that we're about to create. Now this will take a while, and it's slow as shit because I managed to pick a bad repository. So yeah, excuse me for picking a slow repository. Oh, there we go. There we go. Now we are getting some speed. Installing. I see we have some missing signatures or unsigned packages. That's Rawhide. most of the time is spent on installing packages. But I wanted to demonstrate the whole process. I basically automated much of this stuff myself, but that script is not ripe for consumption by anyone else than me, because it's basically a lot of stuff hard-coded in there. So I just wanted to demonstrate the whole process in a way that others might be able to reproduce without requiring any specific scripts. Text Life, this is one hell of a suite. It's huge. Now this SECLC spec file that we just pulled is not a proper spec file. Really proper. It does the job for me, but there's a bug in there. It shouldn't by default create documentation and install documentation. The idea was to create a separate document package for that, but that didn't quite work out, and I didn't find the inspiration to fix that, because it's such a minor bug. All right, so we're here. So let's just build this stuff. RPM build. Build all, and then point to the spec. And the spec is called SECLC spec. And that should create our compiler. It's creating documentation. The SIL reference guide PDF file. It will be installed once you install the package. So let's install it. Sudo rpm uvh and just get the URL. And it's this one. And just paste it in, and that should install the RPM. All right, we're done. Next step will be to actually take care of some things. Let's just first disable some services and replace some services because of some prerequisites of my implementation. Sudo shell. Let's have a look at the current processes. Now it looks nasty. Well, actually it doesn't look that nasty at all. It actually looks okay. And that's probably, well, it doesn't quite look okay, but it doesn't look that bad either. But as you can see, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the policy, but in Fedora there's an unconfined service domain that is used for system services that are currently not covered by the policy. As you can see, there's a lot of stuff in there with that. So RDD, for example, currently runs in the unconfined service T domain, which basically means that the policy doesn't apply to RDD, which is a bug in the policy that somehow this shouldn't happen. Sorry for the background noise. There are some carpenters working. So we'll just take care of this stuff. First of all, let's just disable firewall D. System control disable firewall D. And stop firewall D. We don't use firewall D. And then just install yum install IP table services. enable IP table services. Enable IP tables. This is it. And then start IP tables. And just confirm that it is working. IP tables. This. And it's working. Let's just disable some stuff. System control. Disable. SSHD. I don't cover, I haven't, it's not covered yet in my policy. Modem manager. It's not covered with by my policy either. And cron-d. It's not covered by my policy either. PS out. See if I missed something. No, this looks okay to me. So, there is. There are a couple of issues. One of which is that actually I'm not going to explain what the issue is. I'm going to show you how to fix it. CP user type systemd system db socket. etc systemd system and then dbus socket edit that file in etc. And what we do is we change the path from varrun to run, because we no longer use varrun in Fedora. There is a symlink in var to run, but that kind of messes with the policy for some reason, which I was not able to identify. But we'll just change that to run, because that's the actual path of the socket. Now we'll also do the following. CP user lib temp filesd. And then we'll copy some files in it. Script conf, I think it is. Bam conf and screen conf. Those are the ones that we'll need. And yeah, others might, you might want to review the others as well, but currently these are the ones that apply to my demonstration. And the same goes for the services. There is not a bug in the emergency service where the su login command is run from a shell, which is really weird and stupid. But that causes issues, because that makes it so that su login ends up in the uncovered domain, quote unquote, which basically is a quote unquote unconfined domain. However, it's ironic, because the unconfined domains are not allowed to read etc shadow, and su login needs to be able to read etc shadow, so shit hits the fan. But since we're not going to test emergency mode in this demonstration, I will just not fix that. But just note that in Rawhide currently the emergency service unit has a bug which causes problems with my policy. But that's not a due to a bug in my policy, that's due to a bug in the systemd package in Rawhide. Anyway, so let's copy this file to etc temp file files.d. Copy these files. Let's go to etc temp files.d and edit these files. So let's edit init scripts. Nano init scripts conf. And just change the path from far run to run. That's all that's needed. I'm not sure if you're familiar with etc versus user lib, but etc overrides user lib, so you can actually make changes to existing configuration files installed by a package by copying it to etc and then changing it in etc. That way you won't have to worry about configurations getting reverted when you upgrade a package, because etc will always override user lib, and no files will be installed to etc, so you won't have to worry about it being overwritten by some package. That's the main idea. And just do this, and that'll take care of the bugs in the configuration. Alright, so now it's time to actually get to the meat of the demonstration. So we'll get to cd etc as Linux. Clear to clear the screen, and we'll make a directory, make dir e145. This is the name of the policy model, and what we'll do is we'll chown that recursively for Joe needs to be able to manage the policy, or is the policy manager 145. And what we'll do next is we'll exit, and as Joe, we'll just cd to etc as Linux. As Joe will clone my e145 repository, so it's git clone www.github.com the override, and then e145 period git, and this should might wanna prefix that, and this should get that, so it should be in e145. Let's go to next what we'll do is we'll create a directory in there, make their p e145 policy, and lsrz e145 to see how that looks. So it's basically a git repository in etc as Linux, and it has a bunch of files and directories in there, and we created the policy directory manually there. That's important. All right, so now that we took care of this stuff, we'll need to create a simple script that we can use to actually build policy from this source content. So I'll just go to user, I'll just go to root first. And then I'll go to user local bin, although you might know of a more suitable location. And I'll just nano a file called e145, that makes kind of sense, I suppose, and create a simple bash script, bin bash. And this script runs user bin seclc compiler in verbose mode. Always run it with in verbose mode. It has some very interesting information there that is just fine to see. If it shows something, then you know, then it's something that you should know. All right. So what it needs to do is it actually needs to for every entry in the listing file in user or etc as a Linux e145 source listing, it needs to prepend that entry with a particular path. So for each in bin cats etc as a Linux e145 source listing, do echo etc as in Linux, E145, and I should actually put this on another line because it's going to get nasty and we want to keep it readable. Source and this should be fine. Now we need to output the stuff to etc as in Linux E145 policy, and the file name is policy29 currently. But yeah, this needs to be, you need to make a variable there or something like that. Oh, and then we also need to output the file context file to etc as in Linux E145 context files file context. And that's basically, this should be basically it. So let's just try this out. Let's just gmod plus x E145 and let's see if there's no bugs. But exit this command, you should be able to run that. Actually, you can just command and run it from wherever you like. I should be able to run that as an unprivileged user. User local bin E145. And of course, there's an error. There's always an error. Oops. Why can't I just? Oh yeah, might wanna done it. E145. Oh, actually. And now it works. So if I now look at ls all set etc as in Linux E145 policy, there's a file in there. And the same goes for context files. File context file is created there by the compiler. The other files, media and file context subs disks, were already there. So that's basically it. So we are in a force mode, aren't we? Oh. Yeah. So it's time to get into a permissive mode. Ah, sudo shell. And let's have a look, by the way. I wanna see something. And it looks okay this time, so okay. Set a force 0. And now we'll edit the file etc as in Linux config to tell as in Linux to use my E145 policy. Just point it to E145 rather than targeted. E145 and then just exit that. Now we can run the load policy command to actually load my E145 policy into the system. Now this will invalidate the current context and stuff in the system. So it will mess with the system. So don't do this in enforcing mode because that'll make all hell break loose. To show you that, this is the proof. So a lot of these contexts end up with the invalid underscore T type, which basically is as Linux telling us, hey, this this process has a context that is invalid and it'll break. You need to take action. And that's what we're going to do. Now, next step is for us to restore the context of persistent file system, of objects on the persistent file systems. So we'll just restore con, and I'll be doing this manually. I won't do verbose because it's just it's going to spit on the screen like crazy, and I don't want to do that. But this will take a while. And note that I'm using the dash capital F here, which is required. What's going on here? What the hell? Weird. Oh. Why isn't that? Maybe it's I'm messing with my I have no clue what's going on here. No such file or directory. Oh, I think I know. Oh. Let's just do this, see if that makes any. No. And a fixed file relabel will not deal with this. Let's see if this. It sounds like I'm in at a dentist and I have some cavities. I'm not sure if you hear that in the background, but that's the carpenters. But this is weird. It says no such file or directory. Now, I wanted this demo to go smooth, but there's always some shit somewhere. I'll just try this. But this is not sufficient. Aha, this is it. There's a bug in my script somehow, and I thought that file exists. I actually verified that. No such file directory. So yeah, there's a bug in my, let's just fix that. User, I was already wondering why is this not working. Etc. Context files. Oh, there's a typo there. It's a minor typo. It's a minor typo. Sorry about that. So yeah, need to fix that. I was already wondering what the hell is going on. Alright, so now, sudo. Now it should work. Okay, this is going to take a little while. It's going to relabel the whole file system almost each and every single file. I'm going to listen to my dentist. It's actually done. Let's have a look. Then probably printing stuff is what's taking so long. So you see this, the home directory is labeled properly. And this seems to be labeled properly as well. So we can actually just reboot. So we're currently in permissive mode. We're rebooting in permissive mode. So it shuts down in permissive mode, but it will boot up in enforcing mode. Let's see if this works. So it's now booting in enforcing mode. And there we have it. Let's log in. And let's just run screen. And let's just sudo to session role and the session domain. And have a look at the out search output, because previously in my previous test I got some really nasty stuff. They asked 11:46 and it's still there, seems to be. Oh, actually no, it's not. There's a lot of stuff here. The hell? This noise in the background is not making it any easier for me. Now this is all old stuff. This is all from before I booted. So it's not, this doesn't apply. So let's just reboot again, but this time we're in enforcing mode. Get enforced. Just to give you an example. So it's 11:47. Everything is clean. Let's just reboot. And then we know at 11:47. Everything was still fine. The AVC that now that we were seeing were due to that sysadmin thingy is still there. Yeah, you probably don't know about it, but there's a seems to be a bug in, I think, DLibC or something like that, where processes request a sysadmin capability where they really shouldn't. Now, this might be glibc or something like that, but you can ignore those. Those won't actually cause any big issues. It's just that it prints it to the screen, which is annoying as hell. But it won't. It didn't prevent me from logging in. It's a login program that actually requested sysadmin. But here's two AVCNLs that I want you to at least that I want to at least explain. Here, actually, systemd is trying to create a directory called systemd in a directory which is currently labeled with tempfst, and that directory is actually run user 1000. And let's have a look at that directory. So here you have run user 1000. Now this directory is mislabeled. What actually happens is that systemd mounts a tempfs file system on this directory, which causes that type to be associated with that actual directory. And that's wrong. So what logind or logind does that stuff, and what logind needs to do is actually do a lsetconf on that directory after it mounted tempfs on there, so that the label of the directory is proper. But for now we'll just do it manually, restore from rvf. So this is basically something I do every time I boot up, just restore from this directory to the directory specified in the policy, to the context specified in the policy, because, well, Pulse Audio uses that directory and some other stuff as well, so you want to make sure that. But the issue is that Pulse Audio is not allowed to create the systemd directory in there, and then the generators directory in there, and then some SOC files in there. Now, eventually this will break something, some systemd functionality, but I'm not going to allow this as is, because that it would require me to give more privileges to systemd to allow this, and it's not needed. But logind just needs to fix that, and then these should go away, these AVCDNLs, at least for the most part. So that's basically it. This is just keep in mind, I haven't actually touched on this, but let me finally touch on that, and the rest I'll leave that up to you to figure it out. When you log in, in the context of Joe, you, Joe, R, Joe, T, which is a very confined environment to be in. You can't do much there. For example, if I do a PS AUX capital Z, I can only see my processes. If I do a LS all C root, I'm getting permission denied. It's very restricted, but I can run screen. I can run other commands like git, for example, sudo. So the idea is that there's this unprivileged login domain, and if people want to do some privileged stuff, they should run sudo and go to the session domain, and that's when I run the sudo command with the dash r session underscore r, the dash t session underscore t, and then run a shell in the privileged command domain, and now I can actually run see all the processes on the system. But now I'm also root, but you can also do it without becoming root. So if you just use this one here, you Joe, then you'll stay Joe but in a privileged domain, and now you can also see everything. And that's just important to understand also with regards to maintaining your policy. I actually have some weird setup here in this policy. Basically, I'm saying, okay, Joe can manage the policy store, but he must be in the session domain to do so. So if you just log in as Joe and you try to get to etc Azure Linux, then it's permission denied. But if you change to the session domain, then you'll be allowed. And and you'll be allowed to edit the files there because you own the files in E145. That's so, and then you can actually also run the E145 command. But yeah, it's in, it has some environment issues, so you need to actually use a local bin. But you'll be able to build the policy, update the policy. But then if you want to actually load the updated policy, then you'll need to be root again. So that's basically exit and then root. And now you can load the updated policy. But basically how you do that is basically you'll switch a lot of contexts and a lot of identifiers. And you basically, what I would basically do is basically create a branch, a local branch in the E145 repository, like for example, my stuff. And then if you have local changes, then you add them to your local branch and you keep masters, keep that in sync with upstream. And then you'll basically, if you want to update your policy, then you'll just do a git pull in the master branch so that it pulls in the changes from the git server, the main git repository, and then just merge those changes into your my stuff branch to merge that in with your local customizations. And that's probably how I would do it. So yeah, you need to be aware of Joti and session T, and don't be fooled by the Joe name. I just use that. But you could, if you're familiar with ref policy, you could compare the session domain with the ref policy sysadmin domain, and you could compare the Joe domain to some extent to the ref policy staff domain, although not quite, because Joe _T is much more restricted, but Joe _T is allowed to run sudo to change to session domain. So in that sense, it is it is similar. Now let's just show you how one of the rules that I have. I'll just finish it up real fast. But there's a boolean here. Get a cbool. There's a bunch of booleans. But I'm pointing to prif user login, which basically allows me to specify whether one can log in directly in the session domain or not. And currently it's set to off. So if I exit, and try to log in as root is mapped to session, to the session domain. So root logs in as session. But that's not allowed. And by toggling the boolean, do I have that in my history? Yeah. Get a cbool all set a cbool. And then set a prif user login to on. And now it's set to on. And I exit now. And if I now log in as root, it works fine. So that's just some neat little thingy I put in there so that to be sure that no one logs in directly in a privileged domain. And that's basically it. For the remainder of the stuff, just figure it out yourself. Just keep in mind that it's a policy. It's not meant for the masses. It's meant for people who want to have power have a say over what happens in the system, who aren't afraid to get their feet wet, aren't afraid of the policy language, who can write, who can speak as Linux policy language fluently. People want to go back to the basics. They don't want to use all those redundant utilities like SEManage, SEModule. They don't need those utilities because they recognize that those utilities add more complexity rather than rather than making things simpler, because they require that you learn more syntax, more commands. Whereas if you just learn the basic policy language, then you're done in my implementation. You don't have to learn all those SE manage commands to do stuff. You can just edit your text files directly and be done with it. So although SE manage was designed to make SE Linux policy administration easier, I beg to differ. It doesn't make it easier, it just adds more commands to learn. But my implementation requires that you speak SE Linux language. And that's something that SE manage says, okay, we'll just give them those commands because they're not going to learn the language either. And that's not in my implementation, I require that you can speak to SE Linux directly, not via some application. So that's one of the things, and it's a very bare policy. So yeah, there's bugs, of course there's bugs, it's full of bugs. It's a huge task to actually write a policy that works in most scenarios. So yeah, just stick with what I showed you, create that user Joe, use that user Joe, install a minimal system, remove the services that I removed, or disable them, replace them, use IP tables, and then use some basic apps. So on my laptop, I have this on my laptop, I use stuff like RC, Screen, Sudo, Mutt, Newsboater, BTI, Emacs. Those are stuff that's all covered by the policy. As the info is not installed, I could just install it. Yeah, install SE tools. Console, but then you can see, have a feel, have a look at what apps are covered by the policy and what not. But yeah, that's just it requires that you can actually parse the policy. That's the whole idea about this stuff. So as you can see, this should just work, but there could be bugs in the RPM stuff. So be careful especially kernel. If you update your kernel with RPM, then do that in permissive mode, because I have it, I'm working on it, but I'm using a UEFI system, and so I don't test it often on non-UEFI system, so it might break there because it's different setup in /boot. So anyway, SE info application subject, and here you have some of the stuff that is covered, and a lot of it is not really the user application, but here you have them. For example, BTI FFmpeg is to some extent covered, rTorrent is covered, Elinks is covered, Emacs, Git, Dig, Git, email, GPG, pin curses, smart card daemon, GPG, PCSC for smart cards, MUT, MUT GPG, so MUT can be used with GPG, RC, newsbeater, potbeater, screen, SSH, SSH agent, pulse audio, mock, sudo, and vice sudo. And then a lot of pulse audio apps and admin apps are covered. But yeah, so it's a work in progress. Just keep that in mind. So give me a break. Don't make it too hard on me by doing stuff that you know that's not supported. And if you do, then just send me patches to support it. But just keep in mind that it's a work in progress. So that's it. That's it.